amazing and commit your life to Christ, anything is possible. If you believe in Him, you could change this nation for Jesus.
Morning. We want to welcome our friends from Mexico that are going to be leading us in worship today. Look up there and welcome them this morning. Now, we're going to sing in Spanish and in English. We're going to start out in Spanish. The words will be there. You can make your best stab. Pastor Jeff on the first service didn't miss a word. Maybe. So look at the words. Go ahead and throw it up there. Let's sing together. 14, sing it out.
Por ti los cielos ven, los mundos cantarán, en ti la vida está, por ti puedo cantar, la oscuridad se va.
Nadie como
nuestro Dios. gonna make this declaration. No matter what language, if our God is for us, who can be against the church? No matter the language, every tongue, every tribe, every nation proclaiming the goodness of God. And if our God,
and if our God is for us,
sang at Easter, going to be led by one of our Spanish friends, and at least going to sing a verse. You see what? You better get used to this. Come on, somebody. You better get used to that, to what heaven's going to be like. Every tongue, every tribe, every nation gathered around the throne, bringing in praise. Amen?
Oh!
several years ago, we would have never done this because we were so prideful. Come on, somebody. We didn't mix together. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. Come on, somebody. You know what I'm talking about. But God is breaking down walls. Come on, somebody. He's breaking down walls where our especially our young people are growing up realizing that we are one people when we gather around the throne. Oh, come on, somebody. You know what I'm talking about? And so we're going to sing this song here. We're going to go to Spanish for a moment. Canto, which means to sing, our hallelujah. And vivo está, the Lamb has come, overcome, or he's alive. So we're going to sing that Spanish together. And if you can't sing the Spanish, then you're building a wall up. You know what I'm saying? It happened in the first service. I saw some people, I just can't do that. But I'm telling you what, we're going across the aisle and we're reaching our arms out and we're saying we accept all races, we accept all people because the ground at the foot of the cross is level. And I'm telling you what, pride comes before the fall. So Lord, help us not to be so prideful. Help us to be accepting. And people coming to this place, may they feel the warmth of God's love. Amen. All the way to North Dakota. Come on, somebody. All right, let's sing it together. I done preached that sermon. Let's go on with the sermon. Let's go on with the singing. Enough sermon. Here we go. Canto aleluya. Canto aleluya.
Canto aleluya.
All the church.
Canto aleluya. Canto aleluya. Vivo está. Canto.
Be seated.
Wow, what a great morning it is. I don't know about you, but I'm kind of excited a little bit, all right? You know why? Because this is a bigger picture. Like Mark said, y'all realize that we have guests from North Dakota. We've been privileged to have one of my teenagers grow up and be an adult, almost an adult, Lance, okay? Lance and Lena are here. We're going to kind of say their formal farewell. They'll be here, Lena will be here just through June, and Lance will be through the summer. But, you know, they've worked hard because they didn't want to leave North Dakota without anybody. And they have Pastor Omar and his wife, Kate. He has Keith and Morgan and Melissa. And they are coming to take up and minister in North Dakota like never before. They have a heart for teenagers and children and adults. And it's been exciting already what they're doing. And so come join us at lunch because there's some great things happening. So, you know, our Samaria, we've talked about going to the ends of the earth. Well, we also talk about Samaria. North Dakota's Samaria and Mexico is our Samaria. We had the privilege to drive down Thursday, pick them up early Friday morning and drive them up here. And tomorrow morning, we're going to drive down and turn around, come back. Because we believe in what's going on here. We have a group that is getting the opportunity to hear about Jesus, and we're so excited. So if you're our guest, I want you to understand, this is a church. It's bigger than just us. It's about ministering. We've had people from River Trails over here helping us translate. We had a group from Mexico go over and sing over at River Trails. Because we're what? We're one church in two locations. Truthfully, we're one church all over the world because we're all believers in Jesus Christ. And so that's what it's about. But just for a minute, I'm going to welcome them. I've done it before, but I'm kind of proud of myself. It's Buenos Dias. Estamos felices de tener a nuestros amigos de Piedras Negras, Mexico. Con nosotros esta mañana. We're glad you're here. I had my cheat sheet, okay? I had my cheat sheet. But you know, we got great people in the church. Y'all don't realize, one of our members said, you know, I could get 200 desks. And so we loaded up a big U-Haul and trailer. And we took 200 desks to bless them, because see, this is just a small portion of the school. Over about 9 years ago, I met Chuy and Nidia in Mexico then. Chuy was the pastor down there, and God's changed his route and brought him here, and I'm so excited. But through that, yeah, let's tell them. They're doing good. I didn't know he could play air guitar, though, but that's okay. But, you know, I said, Chuy, there's a building over here in this tall grass, and long story, I even got to help dig the first hole for the baños, and we started building a school. When we went back the other day, they already built two more classrooms. Y'all, they have a school of 500 children already at this school. Yeah. Is Gregorio here? Gregorio, where are you at, buddy? Wave your hand. Gregorio, he is the principal of the school, and he was over at River Trail, so I didn't get to introduce him. But he is known in the community as one of the best Christian schools in Piedras Negras. And my heart is for our church members to get that vision. Y'all, it's a mile over the border. So if you have a passport, pray with me, because we want to pick up and start ministering with them, continuing that ministry. He is a burden for these students. He said, Kim, some of these students don't know Jesus Christ, and though this weekend we're talking to them about it, so pray with us on that. But right now, I'm going to let y'all get an opportunity to kind of meet them. They're going to come on and sit down here, and when we want to greet and meet, it's not about us. Don't forget our North Dakota people over here. Welcome one another this morning. You do that. God bless you.
What a glorious day. What a glorious day.
May be seated.
Earlier this week, I had the opportunity to kind of wrap up our year at Beach Club, and I was just thinking this morning about all the ministry opportunities just in the week, the people we've been able to engage with and ministering in our schools right here, telling them about the love of Christ. As Kimberly mentioned, from the north and from our south, so blessed to be here with you ministering here. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Father, what a blessing it is. What a privilege it is to be here, Lord, in your house, worshiping together, God. Just a tiny, tiny, tiny snapshot of what it will be like in heaven someday. And Father, we're grateful for the opportunity. Father, I thank you so much for the faithfulness of the people who give their tithes and their offerings, Lord, out of obedience and out of love for you, God. Because, Lord, those monies are used to take your word to the ends of the world. Thank you for letting us be part of that. May we always see it as a privilege to be able to give, not just in our money, but in our time, in our prayers, in our hearts, Lord. Father God, stretch us, take us out of our comfort zone, and grow in us a love and a passion to continue to take your word to the ends of the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Church, let's stand together, sing it out in any language.
he shall come with trumpet sound. Oh, may thy name in him be found. Rest in his righteousness alone.
Faultless to stand.
Faultless to stand before the throne.
Church said, our Lord and our God, in different languages, from different places, but all of your people. And there is coming a day that you've already told us, and so we need to be ready, and we need to be sharing the good news that all others will have the opportunity to ready themselves, to be clothed in your righteousness, because you, O God, have exalted Jesus to the highest place.
You have given him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue, regardless of what we speak today, will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. As we will one day do, gathered around your throne from every language, tribe, people, and nation, so too this is a preview of heaven this morning. Be pleased with the praises of your people as we live in anticipation of doing so before you face to face for all of eternity. Between now and then, teach us how we might be best prepared to live, to die, because Christ is Lord, all in all. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Y'all sound really good in Spanish. I thought about preaching in Spanish this morning.
Amen.
But que pasa? Taco and adios will be the shortest and most unbiblical message you've ever heard. So let me instead tell you about the city of Izmir, the third largest city in Turkey. But you may be more familiar with it, and so was the rest of the world, especially the Western world, the Greek culture, up until 1930 when it took on that name, because prior to that it was known as the city of Smyrna, the second of the seven churches that the book of Revelation is addressed to, and that we're studying because it has implications not only for those first century Asian churches, but also for us as well. Smyrna was one of the most beautiful cities in the ancient world. It's situated on the Aegean Sea, as is Izmir today. It was a planned city, and so you had these wide boulevards sweeping throughout the city. Upwards to through the city, that the most famous city was known the Golden Street, and through the city streets, across the foothills up to the mount, where there was this massive temple to Zeus. It was a city that also knew both about, in essence, dying and coming back to life. It had been established as a Greek outpost 1000 BC. 400 years later, it was overrun, and for about 400 years, it was left as nothing more than a small collection of villages. Then Alexander the Great came upon the idea, conceived of the idea of rebuilding the city, which was actually carried out by one of his generals, so that Smyrna became one of the model Greek city in the ancient world. It was a place in which you had this massive architecture. Greek culture was highlighted. The Colosseum that held the annual famous games, a magnificent public library. There was a stately structure for the playing of music. There was the largest, or one of, if not the largest, theater in the ancient world, held 20,000 people. Smyrna was also claimed to be the birthplace of the great writer Homer. And so the people of Smyrna were engaged in architecture and Greek culture, in the games, in productions, in music, in the arts, in the festivals, as well as temple worship. If you were a Greek living in that latter part of the first century, Smyrna would have been an ideal place to live, unless you were a Christian. The name Smyrna is the Greek term that appears in the Bible for myrrh, the ointment or the spice. It appears three other times other than this passage, all in reference to Christ's death. It was foretold, you recall, for it was one of the gifts by the Magi. The gold represented his kingly nature, the frankincense his priestly role, and the myrrh was a foreshadowing of his coming death. It was used as he was on the cross in a mixture with wine offered to him to help deaden the pain. After his death, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus came to him, and they took his lifeless body, and they wrapped it in linens along with 75 pounds of spices, including primarily that of myrrh, and they laid him in the tomb. And so the very name Smyrna, especially among Christians, conjured up the idea it was a symbol of persecution and affliction, tribulation, and yes, even death. With that background, it makes these words even more pointed. When in Revelation, the second chapter, we read, beginning in the 8th verse, to the angel, and we remember last week, at least I believe, that is speaking to the lead pastor, some would say to the bishop of each of these churches. To the angel, to the pastor of the church in Smyrna, write, these are the words of him, that is Jesus Christ, who is the first and the last, who died and who came to life again. I know your afflictions and your poverty, and yet you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan, a gathering of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful, even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. For he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He who overcomes, and that word overcomes is addressed to each of the seven challenges to these seven churches. To the one who overcomes, we saw last week, it's the word Nike, victory. To the one who overcomes, this is true of all Christians, he will not be hurt by the second death. This speaks, although it is to the first century Christians in Smyrna, it's also to the 21st century church today. As it speaks, first of all, of the afflictions of this life. And you will, in all probability, at some point or another, be told or be taught by some within the Christian community that if you just have enough faith, as Christians, with enough faith, you are destined to a life of health and wealth. But I find nowhere that Jesus made that promise. In fact, what we find is Jesus talking to this Christian group in Smyrna. And by the way, they are one of only two churches out of the seven in which Jesus has no word of criticism. Remember last week to the church at Ephesus? He said, this one thing I have against you, you have lost your first love. There's no word of condemnation to the believers in Smyrna. And so it wasn't a matter of them having a lack of faith. Far from it. He affirmed them, unqualified praise. And yet he said, I know of your affliction. I know of your persecution, your imprisonment, that which you are suffering. It's affirmed elsewhere in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, which we often call the hall of faith. Those women, men and women who lived in such a way that they inspire us. And among the Abrahams and the Moseses and the Gideons, the Samuels, the Davids, there are also these in whom it says others were tortured. Some faced jeering and flogging, while others were chained and put in prison. They were stoned, they were sawed in two, they were put to death by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, mistreated. They wandered in deserts and mountains and in caves and in holes in the ground. So much for the prosperity gospel. These suffered. And throughout history, those who have followed Christ, those who have followed God, and then as revealed in Christ, have experienced suffering. The word affliction here is used to refer to pressure, literally a weight that could crush one to death. What's weighing you down today? Is there unjust pressure being exerted against you? Is it the weight of your own sin that weighs upon you? But what is afflicting you today? The people of Smyrna experienced great affliction. He said, I know your affliction, I know your poverty. There's two different words translated poor in the Greek New Testament. One talks about the man who works to his fingers to the bone. He does everything that he can. And yet at the end of that, it's kind of like what we'd say today. He lives from paycheck to paycheck. And the very best he can do is just barely eke a living. He just barely gets by. He has nothing left over. That's not the word used here. The word used here is not the one who has nothing left, but rather the one who has nothing at all. He is financially destitute, which many of these Christians were because of the economic sanctions imposed upon them because of their faith. Has nothing. Now, by the way, it's also the same word that Jesus used in the Sermon on the Mount when he said, blessed are the poor in spirit. When we declare our moral bankruptcy, our righteousness, we are destitute of righteousness apart from Christ, then he will bless us. But Jesus is saying to this church, these Christians in Smyrna, I know of your heavy affliction. I know of your absolute economic and financial poverty. And he said, I know of the slander of those who call themselves Jews. That is, those Jewish in tradition but had failed to place trust in the long-awaited Messiah. You go back and read the book of Acts, and you'll find time and time and time again how the Jews stirred up the crowds of people in the Greek cities against the Christians. It happened in Antioch, in Iconium, in Lystra, in Thessalonica. Because the Jews considered that these Christians, most of whom obviously had come out of the Jewish faith, that they were the ultimate heretics. Nero was the first emperor who imposed widespread persecution against Christians. He was responsible for the beheading of Paul. Part of his hatred of Christians was fired by his mistress, who many believe that she conspired with Nero to get rid of his wife so she could become empress. He later, and they're not sure whether it was accidental or intentional, Nero resulted in her death as well. But this empress was his mistress was a Jewish proselyte, and she instilled and stirred within Nero, along with others, this hatred of the Christians. 30, 35 years later, it is now under a different emperor, but there is widespread persecution. And so it was that they found themselves, this affliction of and much of it stirred up, and even slander against the Jews. In fact, the last story I'll tell you about the pastor at Smyrna many years later was on a Sabbath day, and yet the Jews were at the very forefront of his execution, breaking all kind of Jewish laws. I know there's slander, I know of your affliction, I know of your poverty, and then he used the word suffer twice. Do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. Now, some of them, I'm sure, were looking for some relief. We've gone through so much, and yet he said there's more to come. The word suffer here is the word basis of our word Passover, the Passover lamb, the lamb that was slain. This is a suffering even unto death. A week ago Friday, I was teaching my team's class at Bell High School. It was on social injustice. Let them choose some of the topics. And many of them talked about religious persecution in our world. And as they started to list some of those, I don't know if I reminded them or told them for the first time, do you realize that while we enjoy religious freedom in this country, at least now, but that in much of the world that Christians are the most persecuted people anywhere in the world? Suffering. Thursday, I'm teaching Beach Club down in Bel Air, and it's a story of Saul's conversion and how Ananias came and Lord impressed upon him, told him to go and help Saul. And Jesus told Ananias, I must show him how much he must suffer for my sake. This is suffering even unto death, which Paul obviously came to know. And then he said, not only that, but there's also a suffering that the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. This was not a 10-day sentence. Rather, the word 10, as it 10 days, it refers to persecution. It is highly symbolic, as is so much of the language in Revelation, and some of you are much more studied about it than I am. But 10 is an intensive number. When used to persecution, it refers to a fierce, an intense, but a somewhat brief in time persecution or plague. The idea of the 10 plagues of Egypt. It was intense. It was fierce. And so Jesus is telling them that there's going to come this intense persecution in your life upon the church for a brief period of time. And so this is the kind of atmosphere and culture in which the Christians of Smyrna were having to live. And it says that the devil will put some of you in prison, you will be persecuted, and it will serve as a test. God was not testing them. But the test, this word is used to refer to that which proves the quality of someone or something. And in this case, I don't know how you and I would do, but the Christians at Smyrna passed it with flying colors. They aced this test because it rose out of and was a result of their relationship with Jesus Christ. Because as severe as were their afflictions and their poverty and all of their sufferings, what they found is that the afflictions of this life are overcome, Nike, because of the assurances of our Lord. And these assurances of our Lord that were true not only for the Christians at Smyrna, but for you as well this morning, at least from this passage, speak of His commands in our lives, His comfort, as well as His commitment to us. His commands are twofold to Smyrna and to us. He said, do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer, and then be faithful. Fear not, be faithful. The word fear here is the basis for our English word phobia. What is it that strikes dread in your heart? What paralyzes you? Remember, Scripture tells you that God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of self-discipline. Jesus said on the night before His crucifixion, but not thinking about Himself, but rather His followers, He said, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, trust in God, trust also in Me. He also said in that same conversation, in this world you will have trouble. So much for prosperity gospel. In this world you will have trouble, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome, Nike, the world. He tells them, do not be afraid. He tells you the same thing. Instead, He says, be faithful. And the citizens of Smyrna knew well about faithfulness, about loyalty. Outside of the city of Rome itself, Smyrna was perhaps the most loyal city in the Roman Empire. So much so that years earlier, the Roman Senate had declared them a free city, that they were free to govern themselves because they knew how loyal they were to Rome. In a war when it was not going well for the Roman troops, the city of Smyrna, the citizens sacrificed and made many provisions that they might succeed. In 195 BC, they were the first to erect a temple in their city to the goddess Roma, the spirit of Rome. They were extremely loyal to the Roman Empire. And so too were these Christians in this church, to a higher allegiance, a higher loyalty. For you see, in 23 AD, Tiberius was Roman emperor, and it was declared that he was no longer simply a man or a monarch, but now he was a god. And so there was a competition, a contest, amongst 11 of the cities of Asia Minor of who would be the first to build a temple to the Roman emperor for emperor worship. And among those 11 include Ephesus that we talked about last week. But Smyrna won the competition and won the right to be the first to build a temple to the Roman emperor for the purpose of worshiping him. All right. Fast forward about 70 years, now under the emperor rule of Domitian. And it is now no longer something new. It is now compulsory. Every Roman citizen was expected annually to go to an altar, to burn incense, to declare Caesar is Lord. And then he received a certificate that he was a loyal citizen. Now, it wasn't always exercised, but without that certificate, there were economic sanctions, and without that certificate, you were liable to death. And so it was that these Christians in Smyrna refused to do so. And so they were running the risk of actually being put to death because of their faith. And so he told them not to fear, to be faithful. As a result, they knew what faithfulness was all about. And then when he said you do that, as you obey his commands, you can be a confident of his assurance, of his comfort. And I think it's found when he said twice in this passage, I know. I know of your suffering. I know of your poverty. That word know, there's again two words in the New Testament translated know. One is I know by observation. That's not the word used here. This word is I know through personal firsthand experience. I know your suffering. I know your affliction. I know your poverty. Hebrews 4 tells us that we do not have a high priest who cannot be touched with our infirmity or our weaknesses, but was at all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. Jesus knows how weak we are. He knows our difficulties. He knows our temptations. He knows our afflictions, our sufferings, our poverty. He knows. And he says, I am with you. He said, I was dead. And the worst that humanity can do to one person, I've experienced, but I'm alive again and I'm with you. It's the promise that we have affirmed in the Old Testament. When God spoke through the prophet saying, this is what the Lord says, the one who created you, who formed you, fear not, I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by my name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned, for I am the Lord your God. He knows what you're going through, and he is with you. Be comforted by his presence and power today. He issues his commands. He offers his comfort. And he promises to you his commitment. His commitment to them was, even though you are destitute, you are poor, I know your poverty, nevertheless, you are rich. For there is a richness that goes far beyond what money can buy. John and I are at a point, season of life, but also this season of the year, that we're going to a whole lot of grandkids' baseball and softball games. We could go Friday, Christian was playing, 12, almost 13, playing over at Texas Star. He's a pretty good ball player. And actually, most of the family had gathered that night to watch. Blake had come, our son, to watch his nephew, and he brought with him Andrew, his fiance, and Andrew's little boy, 5-year-old Mason. He's a great kid. We're really looking forward to them being a part of the family. But as we're watching, you know, you got Audrey and Natalie and Mason here. And Natalie, Mason kind of shy, just trying to get to know us. It's kind of scary. Natalie doesn't have a shy bone in her body, and she's getting a little bored, and so she wants to go to the concession stand. She enlists Audrey and Mason in their appeal, and of course, I'm paying. So we head over to the concession stand, and you know, it's popcorn, nachos, candy, soda drink, soda pop, everything that kids don't need, but that grandparents love to provide. And we're standing in line, and Mason's kind of tentative. He's kind of holding back. And Natalie, again, doesn't have a shy bone in her body, is encouraging him. And just come on, get whatever you want. And talking about me, pointing to me, she said, you get whatever you want. He's rich. Natalie has never hesitated in being liberal with my money. And so we got them all the stuff they wanted. And before we left, I said, Natalie, and I told her what I used to tell her mama when she was little. I said, Natalie, we are rich because we got Jesus and we have one another. And then she did what her mother used to do. She rolled her eyes and ate her nachos. But there is a richness that goes far beyond what money can buy. The word means abounding. You abound, you're victorious, you're rich in this life if you have Jesus. That's in this life. Then he said, in the life to come, I will give to you the crown of life. The people of Smyrna knew all about crowns. As you came from the coastline through the harbor, through the golden street, up the foothills and to the mount, there was this magnificent temple to Zeus and other stately buildings all around. So that these magnificent physical edifices, these buildings all across the crown of the crest of that mount were known as the crown of Smyrna. But far greater than the beauty of ancient Smyrna are the assurances of your Savior. He said, I will give to you the crown of life. Now, there's two words for crown in the New Testament. This one is Stephanos. It's called the crown of life, the crown of righteousness. It's referred to different names. It's the victor's crown, the crown of joy, everlasting life. There's another word, diadema. We get our English word diadem from it. That's not the crown that you and I get. That's the one reserved for Jesus. It's the one that the British missionary to India wrote about in 1770s that has become known as the national anthem of all of Christendom. It says, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him. Crown him, crown him, Lord of all. That's the crown, the royal crown reserved for Christ alone. You and I received the crown that Paul talked about. The last recorded words that he wrote was that I know that the time for my departure has come. I have finished the race. I have fought the fight. I have kept the faith. And now there is reserved for me the crown of righteousness, which the righteous judge will award to me on that day. And he awarded it to Paul shortly after he was beheaded under the proclamation of Nero. It's the same crown of life that he offers to you. The crown of life, you possess that by his grace and your trust in Christ. And the scripture says to those who overcome, Nike, John wrote in one of his letters, he said, and this is the victory, the Nike that overcomes the world, even our faith. You place faith in Christ. And he said, the second death will not hurt you. The second death cannot touch you. The second death is a reference to eternal punishment. Now, we don't like to talk about it in this culture. We don't like to talk about it in church. But church, believe me, there is a literal hell. And everyone is going to spend eternity somewhere. If you have not done so, please place faith in Christ. And having done so, you and I then are responsible for taking the good news of Jesus Christ to the nations, beginning with taking to our neighbors. The crown of life, the second death. For the non-believer, after they experience death on this earth, then becomes an eternal death, eternal punishment. Whereas for the Christian, after death here, there is only glorious, eternal, everlasting living with Christ. Because of his confidence that the second death could not touch him, the pastor of Smyrna, Polycarp, was not afraid of the first death either. Irenaeus, one of the early church theologians, born in Smyrna in 130, sat under and heard the preaching of Polycarp, the pastor of that church. In fact, he said that Polycarp had been discipled in his faith by John the Apostle, who wrote Revelation. A little later, Jerome said that Polycarp had in fact had been ordained to the ministry, had been ordained as the bishop or the pastor of that church by John the Apostle himself. There are many believe that this letter to the angel of Smyrna, it was actually given by Christ through John to Polycarp early in his ministry. Well, fast forward now 60 years later. It's on a Saturday. Many of the Jews, in violation of their tradition, or in the arena with so many others of the citizen of Smyrna, and they begin to call out for the death of Polycarp. The proconsul sends the guards to retrieve him. Polycarp that day, I believe, had told his disciples that he had had a dream, a vision, that he was to die by fire. When the officials arrive, he instructed his household servants or the disciples there to feed them a meal and to provide them anything that they needed. And he requested, and they granted him an hour to pray. After which, as he was escorted from his home to the arena, the chief of the guards begged him to recant. For so many people did admire Polycarp. But he refused. As he walked into the arena, many in attendance said that they heard a voice from heaven say, "Polycarp, be strong and play the man." He stood before the proconsul, who said, "Curse Christ." And his famous statement was, for 86 years, and I don't know if that meant he was 86 or 86 since he had put his faith in Jesus. But he said, "For 86 years I have served him, and he has done me no harm. How can I blaspheme the King who has saved me?" The proconsul said, "Swear to Caesar." He simply said, "I am a Christian." He threatened him with the wild beast. He said, "Bring them in." He threatened him with fire. And Polycarp said, "The fire that burns for only an hour cannot compare with the fire that is unquenchable for all of eternity." And so that aged pastor gave up his life in the flames. But he did so without fear, and he did so absolutely faithful, confident that he had followed the commands of Christ, experiencing at that moment the comfort of Christ, assured that in just moments he would receive the commitment from Christ of the crown of life. And those can be your confidences as well. For regardless of whatever afflictions you may experience in this life, like aged Polycarp and the Christians in the church at Smyrna, greater than all of your afflictions are the assurances of your Lord. And you can live and you can die on that. Amen. Let's pray. God, may this be our faith. For while we're praying for a revival in this nation, and that you'll place people in positions of authority that would help facilitate that. We wait for the outpouring of your Spirit, and we come to you, oh God, in repentance, that we as a people would be what you have called us, the church, to be. But it doesn't mean that things will always be easy. Those in Hebrews 11, when we talk and we lift up those who were so victorious time and time again, but there were those who literally were sawed in two. They were put in chains. They suffered and were afflicted much. We're inspired by stories of Pastor Polycarp, who in the flames lifted his voice to you and thanked you for the privilege that he could drink from the same cup as did Christ, a martyrdom for his faith. May we have such faith. And may we trust, yes, if anyone, those that are not here, that are not placed faith in Christ, I pray that today will be their day of their salvation. But not only be our Savior, be our Lord. That come what may, we will declare, "My trust is in Christ and in Christ alone." So our God, as you move among your people by your Spirit, you issue your commands, you bring to many your comfort, you promise your commitments. May we as a church respond. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you've never trusted Christ as Savior, come. I'll be at the cross. There are people on the side of the walls who want to pray with you. You may want to kneel at this altar. They refuse to go to the altar and burn incense to Caesar. Would you come to the altar and commit yourself to Him? As He leads, we follow today. We stand and we sing together.
The splendor of the King, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps Himself in light, and darkness tries trembles at his voice. How great is our God. Sing with me. How great is our God. All will see how great is our
God bless you very poorly. But let me assure you that God's blessings are much greater than my Spanish. And we're so honored by your presence here and truly pray for God's richest blessings upon you. And whether you're heading back to Piedras Negras tomorrow or you're headed to school or to work, I pray for God's richest blessings upon each of you. As you follow His commands, it's like the Christians in the church at Smyrna and their wonderful pastor Polycarp, as you too are found faithful. May you be richly blessed by your God this week as you go to be His church. Amen.
guides my heart.